I'm Zaid. I manage the infrastructure architecture team at LinkedIn. I also ran the, still run the IPv6 task force inside LinkedIn. So when I'm last year, we came here to talk about the launch of V6 and how we did it. This year, thanks to Eric, we invited back again, and I want to talk about measurements. How do we measure it, and what are we measuring, and want to show some data to everyone. So basically, I'll cover some of the architecture around how we do our measurements. I'll talk a little bit about our global IPv6 growth. I'll show some heat maps. But the main focus of what I want to do today is show you some very interesting numbers around mobile performance and what they yielded. And then just some top IPv6, some data that I think people will enjoy. So what's RUM? Real user metric. Real user monitoring. I live in metrics a lot, I think. So the reason why we use something like this is because we over the last 10 years or so, we've been looking at synthetic monitoring is just not something that cuts it for large scale sort of web companies like us. Every page that we produced for every user at LinkedIn is different, right? So we can't use a synthetic monitoring tool and say, this is what the performance of an end user is like. It's single user based, they're agents only so over the place, but we have 400 plus million users, hundreds of millions of users every day, millions and billions of pages, so that doesn't cut it. So what we are using is a beacon-based technology using JavaScript and Boomerang library to look at performance metrics from real time from browsers. So it's just basically a very, very small image that we embed into all of our pages, and then we get things like TCP connect time, page download time, and all kinds of stuff. And so RUM is basically is largely supported by all browsers now, uses two major things. It's a navigation timing API, and it records performance timers for each of the page loads that you see. And if it can't, then you got JavaScript timers that you can apply to use it. So let's just figure out what we're doing. A lot of you have laptops open right now. If you are on your, either you go to LinkedIn.com or your favorite website that you're on right now. Just do Command Option J if you're on Mac and load it up, and you will see a little bar that comes along the side. Type in RUM equals window.performance.timing, and you'll see a very interesting data that's set for you. This is actually the data that we can collect from every end user that's clicking along our web pages. You can see connect time, connect end, connect start. You can see load time for the page and you can do a little bit more interesting things. You can look at performance timing and say, hey, if I want to look at connect time, how can I do the math quickly to look at that? And it's basically taking a RUM.connect end and subtracting it from connect start and things like that. You can look at download time. You can look at request to response time. And they kind of look like this, right? You can actually calculate, what is your connect time. In this example, it's 136 milliseconds. How long did it take to actually download the content? So you can do all these things, with command. But imagine us doing it for hundreds of millions of users in real time, and then popping it into our sort of a telemetry infrastructure. So let's talk about how we do a little bit of that, right? So imagine all the data that I just talked to you about. You've got it all on web pages. People are clicking all over the place. We take it all in our front end, and we put it into a pipeline system called Kafka, which we have open sourced and is very widely used. And there's two paths out of that. You can do real-time processing using SAMSA, or you can just shove it into your favorite HDFS, and you can run it in Hadoop using all kinds of scripting mechanisms. If you're using it real-time, we have built our own real-time data inserting engine, and we put that into a relational database, and then out it goes into any kind of visualization apps that are created inside LinkedIn. So this is sort of the core of how we sort of do this. So next I'm going to go into the measurements piece. I wanted to just give you guys a sort of brief history on the architecture of how we do these things, and then let's get into the measurements so you can see. So I want to talk a little bit about growth. Last time, I think when I came, we had launched and we were sometime around September 2014, I think we launched, we were about 3% to 4% when we launched V6. And it's been an interesting journey. So we've actually seen a lot of growth. Interesting thing was, I think in April, May of last year, I think it was, we saw interesting spike to 13. We thought we were at 13, 14, you know, getting to 15%, but somewhere along the line, it came down to like 10%. So we are actually, right now we can confidently say we are 10%. I don't really know why we hit that 13, 14% mark. We are theorizing that it could be because, you know, there was someone actually, some large provider may have actually turned on V6 and then turned it off. We don't know yet. But we have yet to sort of, when I actually ran this data, we thought, well, we'll try to dig back and look into it and see what happened. So maybe next time we can talk about it. So all that RAM stuff I was talking about, I just wanted to show an interesting visualization of a heat map that we can produce out of that. So we can see, like, obviously the reds are where V6 is really hot, and greens are places where, you know, really need a lot more adoption. I think Australia is really close to red, in my opinion, but we'll get there. So that's sort of how it looks on a global scale. We can look in this. Europe looks really nice. North America and Brazil, actually, for us, you know, Brazil. By the way, this is, you know, LinkedIn's perspective, right? All our users at the moment. Brazil is actually one of us. I think our second largest market outside of the US, following India. And
they
so
have, they have three large cable providers basically go off like a rocket on V6 over.
Yep.
Last year, so that's correlating.
Wait, okay, that's good to hear. So yeah, that's sort of the reason we're seeing it.
So ground says no data, or?
Yeah, so basically we're not getting any V6 data out of that. Or it could be so minuscule that that the way we've done the algorithms, they don't pick it, it's noise data. We have to clean a lot of the noise data, maybe it's sort of drowned in that, right? Because I think there's some pockets of V6 data inside Africa. I see it, but it's not showing in this, so. Heat map in the US kind of looks like this. For most of you that do analysis in the US, this may seem very, very familiar. California, sort of East Coast, New York, Pennsylvania, Florida, all look really red. I think there's still a lot of adoption in the US that needs to happen, in my opinion. But these are some of the numbers we're seeing. So let's move on to some fun stuff. So mobile performance is what I've been looking at recently. And I decided to do some numbers here for France. And I was very surprised, actually, looking at all these numbers. I was preparing for this deck. So we see that Orange is like at 15%. Free is like 40% better page download time over V6 than V4. And we've seen this across the board. So let's dig a little deeper. Like, why is this happening, right? So when we started looking at this, I really thought it was like, you know, we're doing something wrong here. But the more we looked at it, so part of what we can do with the infrastructure that I just showed you is that we can just pick very, very unique time slices and say what is happening to that data. So we looked at free between sort of like a week, given a week. And this is like, times when users are very heavy on our network, on our site, we can see that IPv4 network request is much slower, right? So there's actually network request times that are much higher, means higher TCP timeouts. So we found that V4 was yielding 4.6% sort of timeouts. It means a lot of retransmits forward. What that does is impacts the page overall. So the higher timeouts you have, the more retransmits. And so overall, our pages look worse and worse. And this is 90th percentile, right? So it looks far more worse in that sense. And V6 actually had lower timeouts. And so which means that the deployments of V6 networks are far better. We think this could be CGN related or not, triangulation, we don't know yet. But because of this, we started to look at So our mobile native application, we are still doing a lot more telemetry work on that just to get as much data as we can. But right now we are kind of limited to all, you know, what kind of data we can get. And it's really just, you know, what is the network request? And so we kind of leave it to everyone to figure out what's causing that network delay. And so that's sort of what we're finding. So we started looking at other places, right, around in Europe and Belgium. You can see these are probably your most friendly providers on the mobile side. Huge performance over V6 improvement and V4. We said, okay, let's see what Germany is doing. Germany is about the same picture.
Just understand, when you say, let's say 20%, what does it mean exactly?
It means that that the page download time for V6 is 20% better than V4.
So
over V6.
Something like 80% of the time.
Yes. Yeah. That makes sense. Sorry. Yeah, thanks for asking that. Yeah. So UK, we're seeing some very interesting data coming from different providers, and I think someone here is from the UK. I would love to see BT on that list, by the way, but they're not. So you know, all across the board, it's not just one or two countries. It's all across. Even the US, we started to analyze some data. The most high performing mobile provider that we see from our perspective is Sprint, and the others are not too far behind. Verizon's the only one that's on the low side, but go ahead.
You just said that's the most well-performing provider, but it only says that the improvement compared to IPv4, so if the IPv4 is really bad, you might see it, so it doesn't really give you any...
Well, we don't believe the IPv4 is really bad.
But it could be for this specific
Yeah,
rate, right?
But I mean, I could go and show you that data, but we don't think IPv4 is that bad. If it was, I would not show you this data. Right.
I mean, like I said, it's not IPv4 is not a general event, but there might be a problem for this one operator.
We've looked at that. We would not be very confident in this data if we didn't answer all those questions. So so that's kind of like how it is for performance. Let's see. So I wanted to show some data. Just how providers are doing from LinkedIn's perspective. Comcast is sort of our highest at 25%, has been for a while. AT&T has caught up quite a bit, 15%. The rest are sort of below the 5% mark in terms of visiting our pages and our site in general. So that's where we are. Our message here and going abroad is, to all mobile providers, is just keep doing it faster. And there's a lot of people I'd like to thank behind the scenes who really made this data analysis and everything possible. So I just want to call them out. But anyway, questions?
Very interesting set of data. Do you intend to make them public, such as Google is doing?
Yeah, so we are doing two things. One is you'll see a very soon a blog post with a little bit more detailed analysis than this. Like, we want to go into depths. I was only showing free. I want to show a little bit more examples. So there'll be a blog post. And later in the year, we are going to have a page that will show growth in general and things that you can just visit anytime you want, so we don't have to, you know, come and present every time.
Question, very interesting. Did you find this data useful for your operation workflow? Did you manage to integrate it with your operation and try to fix something, find problems and solve them?
Yeah. Yes, the answer is yes. So RAM is a very, very integral part of LinkedIn's sort of infrastructure, V4 and V6 in overall. And so when, let's say, a site is performing poorly in any part of the world, RAM, you know, alerts, you know, all the operational people that, hey, you know, we see huge performance degradation per AS level and to whatever nth degree we want. Yeah.
Just curious, how often did you manage to fix other people's network?
We only if it is at a very large scale. right? At a very small scale, we don't care. Mostly what we do is we tell operators in friendly environments, hey, we share this data sometimes in the back end with people. I don't want to call them out here, but I have had conversations with many providers about certain things, stuff that I'm not even showing you, that, hey, we need to sort of work on this.
Sorry, last question. So you're doing it automatically, or you're just working on case-by-case basis? So you do have any automated signals to your operations? Since those guys are performing very bad, go and talk to them.
Yeah, it's all automated for the operational folks, yeah. Okay,
someone else? Do you have measurements of the user environments themselves to try to help your customers?
So we do to a certain extent. We're still evolving a lot of that. And we're not in the game of trying to go to the mobile provider and tell them to fix their end user issues or whatever. We use it more for ourselves. Like, for example, to make a mobile better, if we find that Wi-Fi, our app performance poorly on Wi-Fi in general, then we'd like to know that. Is it, something we can do better on the app? So we use it for that purpose, more or less. But we try to do excessive telemetry as much as possible. And we're going further and further as we developed. So yes, we're looking at Wi-Fi, different broadband access rates and things like that. We're sort of getting into that at the moment, yeah.
So, when I'm not in the measurement frame of mind, and I'm feeling more like a consumer, either in small SME environment where we're having to look at technology choices, or in the home, it's kind of weird because inside the tent, we all know that there's like special secret sauce. People have their own special secret sauce. They put boxes there that do special black magic, and it makes things happen. I was talking to you a bit about this at the cocktail party, the fact that as an SME, I can't front on a lot of these people and say, give me exactly the same quality V6 as V4, because they haven't productized it that way, because the special secret sauce only works in V4. But it feels like, from the way you talked about the technology base, you used to do a bunch of stuff, you're actually using commodity platform solutions. You're not using special secret sauce. And you're finding you get good 6 outcomes. And I find that really interesting.
Really. But like RAM in general, right?
Yeah. Just the idea that you don't have to go and get special black magic boxes that do weird tricks on packets to go and deliver good dual stack outcome.
Yeah.
I'm really pleased because I'm trying to find it and the suppliers are saying, no, sorry, the 6 is over there in the corner. Mm. So that was interesting.
Thanks.
Well, if you really want the special secret.
What else?
So, okay, thank you.
Thanks.
And Chip?